Conference designed to make us as HR practitioners to go beyond. I'd like to very quickly welcome here the immediate past president who I understand probably got here by 7:30, leading by example. We want to appreciate you. Let's put our hands together for Mr. Victor Famuyibo. Thank you very much. Thank you. That's how to be a leader. We appreciate you. I'd like to also welcome somebody who also came virtually at the same time, Mr. Sunday Adeyemi, the Chief Executive and Registrar. I'd like to welcome you, sir. You're welcome. Let me welcome the few fellows that are in the house, members that are here, and all of you delegates to this conference. It is day three, and I'd like to welcome you. But for a lot of us that were here yesterday, I'm sure some of the high points of yesterday will be some of the master classes that we enjoyed. And I'm very particular about the wonderful paper about visionary leadership that was done by Tommy Ware. This man is an expert, especially in Asia and Middle East leadership issues. And I'm very sure a whole lot of the issues he raised will continue to be relevant to some of us around here. But the masterclass has also touched upon so many things, but particularly the high point of yesterday was a dinner where we had the very special fellows, six of them in total, that are joining the body of fellows and becoming one of the highest members of this wonderful institute. So I'd like to welcome all of you as you come in. But this morning will be as exciting as yesterday. Our presenter this morning is one of the very finest anywhere in the world. The name of his company for me got me thinking. Gemstones. For some that love gemstones for commercial purposes and for ornamental reasons, I also want to add this morning that gemstones also have metaphysical purposes. Gemstones will stabilize your aura. They will facilitate discernment. Gemstones impart strength and courage. Gemstones open one to innate creative talent. Gemstones purify the body, mind, and spirit. Gemstones facilitate spirituality and contentment. And all of this encapsulates and describes our speaker this morning. He is the Chief Executive Officer of the Gemstone Group, a leadership development institution with a distinct mandate to raise a generation of leaders that are empowered, that are motivated, and that are stirred to operate with natural excellence. We'll try to bring him in because it's not that easy to go deep down to the soil and bring out gemstones. I'd like to call my colleague that was here with you in the morning to do about 2-3 minutes summary of what happened here yesterday, and then we'll bring our gemstone to you. Benjamin.
The President, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, good morning once again. I hope we had a wonderful night rest. Abuja is very great, and if you came in here, you will want to remain in Abuja for a long time. There's no traffic and all the other things that come with, except you will miss the things you buy in traffic in Lagos. You have to go into a proper supermarket here to buy them. Thank you very much for the Lagos people. Yesterday, I'm sure we had a wonderful time. We were able to go through the master class, or probably the master classes, and very, very interesting topics were raised. For those who went to the class where we discussed legal issues and human resource management, I'm sure you know we touched a lot of important issues there. We also had mega trends, the changing economy, and the HR role in employee reward management. That was also another interesting class we had yesterday. We also talked about strategy for business intelligence and leadership for HR leaders, and driving importance performance through organizational development strategies. We also had that class yesterday. One we had here was also the employee engagement and the workplace recruitment rules. We had that also yesterday. I'm sure we all remember the time we had with Dr. Tommy Ware when he spoke to us about visionary leadership, but he dwelt especially on that part where he says, "I am perfectly abnormal." And it's one message we want to go home with: perfectly abnormal. So to be normal will mean to be 9 to 5, to sign in at 8 o'clock and clock out at 4 or 5. But to be abnormal means to go beyond. Can we clap for ourselves for taking this choice? We also had a wonderful session on driving performance in the public service. And during our plenary, we also had the head of service who gave us a deep insight into what the public service is about. And he made a pledge yesterday to merge and ensure that all public HR managers in the public service actually become members of the CIPN. That's something we hope we'll continue to remind him of. I'm sure he's a good man and he will honor his words very soon. So, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I want to prepare us for the next speech, and I'll be bringing my boss quickly. But I want to remind us something. There's some exercise that you do before you start a presentation to be sure that people are listening and they are going to listen to the presentation that is coming up. And this is, I'll just do it quickly and bring you up. I'll just say 1, 2, 3, and I'll say go, and say, and I expect you to clap. Can we do that quickly? 1, 2, 3. Okay, I didn't say go. Okay, I'll do it again. 1, 2, 3. Okay, I'll do it for the last time. 1, 2, 3, go. Okay, thank you very much. The simple lesson behind that is that the average human being, you need to say something to them 3 times before they take it. Let's put your hands together for yourselves.
Yeah, we have our speaker in the house, renowned. We're very proud of him in this country. He has taken the pride of this nation globally. And like I said earlier, he runs a company called Gemstones. And besides Gemstones being very ornamental, and we can use it to make money commercially, researchers have found out that gemstones also have metaphysical qualities. And those I enumerated earlier, they stabilize the aura. They facilitate discernment. They impart strength and courage. They open one to innate creative talent. They purify the body, mind, and spirit. They facilitate spirituality and contentment. And all of that is embodied in our next speaker. He is the Chief Executive Officer of the Gemstone Group, a leadership development institution with a distinct mandate to raise a generation of leaders that are empowered, that are motivated, and stirred to operate with natural excellence. He's a gem of the nation. Please join us and welcome Mr. Fela Durotoye.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Oh, come on. I'm sure that this is day three, and I understand that it must be quite stretching, so much that we've had. But if there's anybody here who has had a really great time at this conference, I would like you to please extend a real good warm hand of welcome to someone that is seated beside you. I know you may have met them before, but this is just one of those things we do in the mornings to warm up ourselves. Say, good morning, it's great to be seated beside you. Don't lie, you are HR managers, you should not lie. It's great to be seated beside you. I don't think it's a coincidence. I think that it's important that we sit together today because there are some things we're going to have to do together going into the future. Once again, very good morning to you. My name is Fela Durotoye, and I am so grateful to be here. I want to thank the organizers of CIPM. Is there anybody that thinks that they've done a great job this year, the organizing committee? Yeah. How do we let them know that they've done a great job? Come on, HR goods. Movement of leaders that are committed to not just personal success or success for their families or success within their careers, but these are a people who have a simple understanding that the security of my prosperity lies in the stability of the environment in which I live. I don't know how many HR managers live in Syria, but something tells me that in Syria, the issues are not very easy for you to manage human resources right now. Crimea, Libya, think about it. Every organization needs a stable environment to be able to prosper and grow. When organizations don't have stable environments, their continued prosperity is insecure. And so, yes, we know people who are going to be willing to do much to advance the course of their organization. We understand that human resources have to be able to ensure that we have competitive leverage. But within the operating environment itself, we must have stability. And so, essentially, Gemstone is all about building a new Nigeria. And it's a Nigeria that we all want. Now, I don't know if anybody here will agree with me that God has blessed this nation called Nigeria. Is there anybody who believes? And I only want those who truly believe in their hearts to please signify by the raising of hand that, no, don't do it because everybody else is doing it. Do you really honestly think that God has stupendously blessed this nation? Okay, is there anyone who thinks that if only Nigeria could be able to use all that it has, that we could be one of the greatest nations on earth? That one I need to know. How many people think we could be one of the greatest nations if only we put judicious use to the things that God has given us? We believe. So, well, if I then say to you that, do you think that a generation has what it takes to transform the lot of its nation? Do you think that nations can be transformed in one generation? So if we say we want to build Nigeria into a most desirable nation to live in, is it impossible? Is it far-fetched? Can our generation do it? No, I can't hear you now. Okay, fantastic. But when we say we want to build Nigeria, are we speaking about whether we want to make it more beautiful than America, more beautiful than Europe or any of the countries? That's not what essentially makes a desirable nation to live in. A desirable nation to live in is a nation where people love to live. They enjoy staying there, living there. But that's not all they. It's a place where people love to work. A place where people would like to play. And they visit, in other words, when they go on their vacation, when it's playtime, this is the place they want to go. And of course, a place where people would love to visit. Sometimes just to see, to be inspired. But I believe that at the heart of all of this, and if you have all these four key things right, ultimately, you will have built a nation where people will want to invest. 83% of the world's lithium is in one country in Africa called Congo. And I can go on and on and on. Everybody recognizes that Africa is the next and the last frontier of hope for humanity in the 21st century. But what I want to show you, I think, might interest you. Ladies and gentlemen, now what do you see? What does it look like? Okay, it looks like a pistol, isn't it? Can you see it? Where is the trigger for this pistol? I don't know. Did you see it? I believe very strongly that Nigeria is the catalyst for the renaissance of Africa. I believe that what you will see in Nigeria, what will happen in Nigeria, will trigger the rest of what will happen in Africa and by extension what will happen for the rest of the world. I believe that Nigeria is uniquely placed, not by chance, not by accident. And we then must begin to understand the responsibility that comes upon us for such a time as this, for being in a place like this. We intend to build Nigeria within our lifetime. And may I quickly just say something that I hope that somebody will be willing to accept here. I believe that you are not permitted to die before 2025. Okay, good. I thought that some people would say amen. Some people probably won't say anything. But please tell the person next to you, I look forward to seeing you by 2025. And December 31, 2025 is really just a few minutes away when you think about it. Cumulatively, it turns to about 10 years, 2 months, and 15 days from now. But this is the kind of thing one person is going to say to you, Fela, what are you talking about? How can we build Nigeria into a most desirable nation to live in? In 10 years, 2 months, and 15 days, is it possible? Anybody talk to me. Is it possible? Well, I found out something called the secrets to all impossibilities. I found one little thing as I was reading through my scriptures one day. And the day I discovered it, in 1997, I looked up, went to my dictionary, got the dictionary, opened it to the letter I, and then I looked for the word impossible, and God bearing me witness, I used a red marker to mark out I am. Because I realized that I had stumbled on a key that makes every impossibility possible. And it's a very simple thing. It says, if as one people, speaking with one voice, they have begun to do this, then nothing that they imagine to do will be impossible for them. Anybody ever heard this line before? Who said this? Can he lie? Does he lie? So in a sense, we have found out that there is something that makes everything called impossibility an illusion. But there is a condition. Once the condition is right, nothing is impossible. And there are four things that we found out are the conditions. Number one, that the people must agree as one people. Can somebody say with me, one people, please? Number two, that they must speak with one voice. Is there anybody that can say with me, one voice? Number three, that they must act with one purpose. Somebody please say with me, one purpose. And number four, that they must create with the same imagination or the same image. I know that many of you here have had the great privilege of building your own houses. And I think that, you know, in the house building or construction site is probably one of the best ways to be able to see what I'm talking about. In a sense, when you come to a construction site, you'll probably find different people with diverse skills, isn't it? So can so anybody please, from the audience, please just tell me, what are some of the people you find on site? Anyway, you know. Carpenters, thank you. Bricklayers, masons, plumbers, electricians, tilers. Okay, have you ever come on site and one person says, well, you know, where are you from, plumber? Because I don't know whether I, carpenter, can work with you on this site. Have you ever seen that kind of thing before? They don't care where everybody is from. They care only why they're there. In other words, they come together as one people, usually as a team. Number two, you may find out that they will speak with one voice, regardless of whatever tribe, whatever tongue, whatever industrial jargon that they speak. They are saying the same thing. And when you get to it, you find out that they are all there to build one house, true or false. But their activities may be different, but whatever each one of them is doing, they're contributing towards building one house. And are they building different houses with different imaginations in their mind? So they're building with one image, isn't it? Usually the architectural design. And so you find out that if any nation is ever going to be built, it's going to have people who are not thinking as Igbo, as Hausa, as Igbira, as Ijo, as Ishekiri, as Efik, as Kanuri. None of those things are going to matter. What is going to matter is that we will be one people, and that will be one Nigerian. In other words, the people that will be able to transform Nigeria must first be Nigerian before they're anything else. Is there any Nigerian in this room, please? Oh, I don't know. Can you please whisper to the person next to you, I am a Nigerian. Now, I don't know where you are from. It doesn't matter. Because, you see, it's not where you are from that matters. It's where we are going. And we are going to build a new nation. We must speak with one voice. Regardless of what dialect we will speak in, we must act with one purpose. And you know the purpose. Purpose answers the question, why am I here? Why? Why am I here? Why was I born here in Nigeria at this time? And of course, we must be trying to build the same country that we all have in mind. Oh. I think they're having a bit of a challenge here, sir. Can they flip this to the projector? To the slides? All right, cool. So essentially what we're hearing, or what we understand, is that the conditions must be one people, with one voice, with one purpose, and one goal. And that is what makes nothing impossible. Is it okay for us to say one people? One voice, one purpose, one goal, and together, nothing will be impossible for us. I want to show you something that I hope will blow your mind. Some of you may have seen it before. There is a nation that most of us have been to, and those of us who have not been, we are hoping to go. It's a nation called Dubai. But what I'd like to share with you is that in your lifetime, in fact, most of you, as you have been professionals, many of you remember where you were in 1990. Most of you had graduated. Most of you had started working. In 1990, the nation called Dubai, that was visited by 87 million people in 2014. This is a nation that looked just like this. Pure bare desert. This is the World Trade Center, 38-story buildings high. Tallest building in Dubai. And in 13 years, this was what they had done. Can I ask you a very simple question? Is this improvement or transformation? We recognize that improvement is any kind of thing that makes things better but not change it. So it's better but not different. Transformation is when things are not only better, but they are significantly different to the extent that you literally cannot find what it used to be in what it is. Does anybody understand where I'm coming from? And just in case you need to see it, can you see? Look at this. This is the same building. The question I'm here to ask you is, where were all these buildings 13 years before? Thank you very much. They were here as imagination. They were visions waiting for visionaries to show up. This is what the International Airport of Dubai used to look like. Some of you probably even flew into this place. And somewhere, somehow, one generation built this, and they could have had great, great explanation. In fact, one of the things that the ruler of Dubai said that was amazing was he said, Dubai has only three things: sun, sand, and sea. Talk about unique selling points. And now, one other generation says, this is what we inherited, but this is not what we're going to bequeath. Does anybody want to have an idea what, and some of you have been there already. What's that magic word we just mentioned a few moments ago? Transformation. Can we say it all together, please? Let's do it. One, two, three, go. This is just the entrance into one of the departure wings. This is what one generation left behind, and another one is leaving this. By 2016, Dubai will be, or will have, the largest airport in the world. They expect that Dubai will become the center, the nervous center of the world travel, air travel. It is expected that by next year, over 150 million people will travel through this airport. The question is, what do they have here that they don't have here? Do they have more land? Do they have more sun? Do they have more sea? Ask someone next to you, what do we have that we haven't found out yet? This was what their immigration used to look like. And you can see the beautiful decoration in their airport. And then, of course, their customs were like this. Anybody remember that magic word again? Without more land or sand, without more sun, without more sea. You remember? They used to do this. Anybody knows any other country where people used to do this? Oh, sorry, forget that. That was funny. This is what can happen when human beings begin to understand purpose. When they begin to see beyond job description. When they begin to understand that I am given a platform to do something bigger that will outlast not only my tenure in that position, but it will outlast my life. This is when we begin to understand that there is a greater KPI than the one that can be measured by your boss. This is what Sheikh Zayed Road used to look like. 1989. Beautiful tall building. This is Sheikh Zayed Road 21 years later. In one generation. Let me just show you this and then I'll move forward. Al Maktoum Bridge, one way going, one way coming. 20 years later, six lanes going, six lanes coming. I can go on and on. One generation left something behind. The other generation did not care what was left behind. They said, what are we going to leave behind? In a sense, there is a human resource asset that Nigeria has that many of you have inherited. You've inherited a culture, a people, a society, and you didn't make it happen. It wasn't your fault that corruption crept into the hearts of the people. So that people coming to the job to do the right thing will go on one-way traffic or against one-way traffic to get to the office. We've come beyond the point where people know what is right and what is wrong and do what is right. We've come to the point where also people know what is right and what is wrong and they choose to alter what is wrong to make it look like as if it's right. It's called all right. All right is two words together, altered right. And now we've come to a point where people actually even think that what is not only what is wrong is right, but what is right is wrong. So that if you stop at a red light and there's no other car passing from any other place, what do the people begin to do? Thank you very much. They begin to say to you, you are stupid. On a Sunday evening, I was coming on Legale Ayorinde in Victoria Island. And some of you may know that street. It's a very secluded street. I'm about to join Ajose Adeogun. And the street light at the junction was red. So I stopped. And there was a lady that was driving behind me in a big, massive Lexus Jeep. Obviously, Nigeria had done her well. And she was honing behind me. But I didn't move until the light turned red or green. And when it turned green and I went on my lane, this lady drove up beside me and you could see in the venom, the anger. And she wound down her glass. And as she was so angry winding the glass, she apparently had wound the glass for the behind. And she turned to me and said, Oriya Okpe, Oriya Okpe. And as she was saying Oriya Okpe, which means you are insane. I could see two little children behind popping their head out to see this guy who was an insane guy for stopping at a red light. You see, she had just trained. A whole generation had just gone through their own driving test, their first driving lesson. That is the society that you have inherited. But is that what you're going to bequeath? That is the question here. These guys have decided to do the impossible. One last thing I want to show you. There's a project that they're working on now called the Rotating Skyscraper, which means simply that there are these buildings that are going to be ready by 2017, where when you look out of your window, you would see one angle of Dubai. By tomorrow, when you look out of your window, you are seeing a different angle of Dubai because the building is moving, but you can't feel it. And the simple understanding behind this is that, does anybody know that the earth is spinning right now? Do you feel it? And the architect said, if the earth can spin and the people in it don't feel it, then it is possible for a building to turn and the people in it won't feel it. And this is what the building is going to look like. It's going to be ready by 2017. The question is, what kind of thinking produces this kind of unbelievable results in one generation? Anybody get any ideas? Any ideas? What kind of thinking produces this? Visionary? Out of the box? Going beyond. Tell somebody you gotta go beyond the norm. This is what the estate is going to look like by 2020. They're building the first one, prototype, by 2017. And then within the next 3 years, they would have built about five of them. These guys have a very simple mind frame that nothing is impossible. Nothing. And I love the way that Nelson Mandela says it. It's one of the things that I always want you to believe. Because when you are leaving this place, you are going to be challenged with impossibilities. If you are not challenged with impossibilities, ladies and gentlemen, I do respect you greatly. And I would love to make acquaintances and friends with you. But I would have said to you, you've wasted your time. Time is life and life is time. And if you invest 3 days of your lifetime coming here to leave this place the way you came, then you have committed suicide. Because if time is life and life is time, if I waste your time, I've committed murder. If I waste my time, I have committed suicide. So it's not the way you came into this conference that matters, it's the way you leave. If at the time when you leave this conference, and by this time next year, nothing significantly changed in your organization, in your industry, then you have committed suicide. Tell the person that is next to you, please, if you like the person, please don't commit suicide. Because there is a power that comes together when we come together as a people. The power to do what is practically impossible. If we can think as one people, if we can speak with one voice. Anybody tell me the next one? If we can act with one purpose. And most importantly, if we can create with the same image. November 1884, 27 people gathered together in a room, in a hotel room in Berlin. And they had a map on the wall that looked something like what today we understand to be the map of Africa. And after 3 months of conversation and negotiation, these guys literally did something that nobody had ever seen literally done before. They began to carve up a continent that was not theirs. And to cut the very long story short, each and every one of them went back, 27 of them, to their various countries. And they had come from Britain, they had come from France, they had come from Portugal, they came from Italy, Belgium, they even came from the United States. And each and every one of them went back to their places and did the same thing. And cut the long story short, ladies and gentlemen, Africa was never the same in 30 years. 27 people gathered together, went back to where they were coming from, and Africa never remained the same. Please, can you hold up to that? Please don't distribute that yet, please. Fast forward 30 years from 1915. A group of young men and women who were born into the effects of the 1885 decision that led to colonial rule. These young men were born into this colonial rule. Their parents did not fight the colonialists. In fact, their parents sold their land and their inheritance to these people. Some of them for a mirror, others for powder, others for little things, insignificant things. But these guys came together in what was called the Fifth Pan-African Conference. And they decided in Manchester in 1949 of them, that they were born into colonial rule, but they were not going to die in colonial rule. And so they decided that it was the purpose of their generation to liberate their nations and their future generations. And to cut the long story short, 15 years from 1945, that conference had started to bear fruit. And in, let me put it this way, 1885, some people gathered together in a hotel room, Africa would never remain the same. 1945, another group of people gathered together in a hotel room, Africa never remained the same. My question is, ladies and gentlemen, what makes human beings think that they can change continents? What makes people think that they can do beyond? They can go beyond their space. Listen, these guys were not thinking about their country. They weren't thinking about their cities. They were taking an entire continent. What made them do so? Well, I believe that it was something that was called the power or the mindset of influence. That they believed that they had the ability to alter or sway not only individuals' thoughts, words, and actions, but groups' thoughts, words, and actions. You have to remember that in 1945, when these guys were thinking of how to liberate Africa, they didn't have age or experience on their side. They didn't have money. They didn't have power. They didn't have positions. Obafemi Awolowo, for instance, was born in 1909. In 1945, he was 36 years old. Ask the person next to you, how old are you again? But these guys gathered together in a room believing that at 36, I can change the destiny of my nation and I can change the destiny of my continent. At 36, without money. Why? Because they found the secret to impossibilities. All they knew was that if as one people with one voice, we can go and begin to do this. Jomo Kenyatta was in that room. He went back to Kenya. Julius Nyerere was in that room. He went back to Tanzania. Kwame Nkrumah was in that room. He went back to Ghana. Obafemi Awolowo was in that room. He went to Nigeria. And these guys were trying to do the same thing in different countries because they realized the same secret that the guys had in 1885. So, ladies and gentlemen, if we could see 27 people change Africa and 79 people change Africa, does anybody have a clue how many we are here? I hear from supposedly very, very, very reliable sources that we are 1,600 strong. 1,600 strong gathered in the Congress Hall of a hotel. They went to a hotel the first time in 1885, Africa was not the same. They went to a hotel in 1945, Africa is not the same. And in 2015, 1,600 people are sitting in a hotel. Will Africa remain the same? So what must we do? Why are we here? Very simple. I don't know how many of you will agree with me that the human resource manager has for many years, not been treated as a true strategic partner. And this may not happen in your organization, so you may not even have a clue what I'm talking about. But I don't know how many of you understand that for many organizations, you can't even become an ED if you're in HR. HR is not seen as core business or core skill for many institutions. In banking, banking is seen as the core skill. HR is seen as a support skill. Whether it's in insurance, insurance is seen as the core skill. HR is a support skill. In fact, when you really want to think about it, isn't it true that most CEOs say that people are their greatest assets? But when you go and look at where HR is put in the organization, you begin to think to yourself, is this how you treat the people who have the greatest assets, who manage them? I don't know whether you would agree with every time that they want to cut down costs, where is the first place that they cut down? They don't sell the cars, they fire the people, the greatest assets first. And I think that there is a general problem that HR managers face. And this is the problem of the mindset of HR managers compared to the mind frame of the CEOs. And I hope you still like me by the time I'm done. I hope so. But is it okay for me to share a few thoughts with you? I think that HR managers don't think like CEOs. I think that somehow we got to believe the hype that we are appendices. We are just an addition to the structure. I believe that they've told us that we are cost centers. And what do you do to a cost center? You cut costs. I believe that we are not seen as profit centers. Is there anybody who agrees with me here, just so that I can know whether I have at least one or two people? So we are so frustrated. And yet the CEOs say, people are our greatest asset. But I don't know whether you recognize this man. Okay, some people already do. His name is Jack Welch. So you know Jack Welch? The CEO of General Electric. As many of you know, Jack Welch ran General Electric for just about 2 decades. He took a company, an institution, that really had a market capitalization of about $40 billion. And by the time he was handing it over, it was over $540 billion. In other words, Jack Welch, literally, under his leadership, GE created value in excess of $500 billion. Jack Welch is celebrated as the greatest manager of the 20th century. So it came as a huge shock to the whole world when Jack Welch said, people are not my greatest assets. Everybody said, what? Sure? He said, no. My greatest assets are leaders. And the first thing that most people thought he had said was that my greatest assets are the managers. And Jack Welch was quick to say, no, don't get me wrong. Don't get this twisted. I didn't say managers, I said leaders. Somebody say leaders, please. He said leaders are different from managements. That leaders are not just people who stand in front of others and tell them where to go. He said, no. Leadership is a mentality of assumed responsibility. Leadership is a mentality of ownership. Leadership is a mentality of accountability, not only to your peers and to those who you report to, but to those who are coming behind you. Leadership, if you're writing down, is a mentality of ownership, responsibility, and accountability. Leaders don't say it's their business. Leaders don't say it's them. Leaders say it's us. Then he went on to define leadership within a very interesting context. He said, leaders are the people who have the capacity to create and deliver desired change. In a sense, what he was trying to say is, most times you will find out that there are three time zones in the life of human beings. There is the past, the present, and the future. Leaders are the ones who are not caught up in the past and who understand that regardless of whatever past has produced where we are, we have the capacity to create a different future. This was what you saw in Dubai. The people who are not locked down by what they inherited to determine what they will bequeath. And great leaders understand that really it's never really this simple separation, that there's actually a time frame, it's a continuum. This is why it's so difficult sometimes to be able to distinguish between the past and the present. Because leaders understand that tomorrow soon becomes yesterday if I can stay up long enough. That it doesn't take long before we will have to give the company we are currently managing to the next generation. Many of you were not born in the companies that you are managing, and I dare say you will not die in those companies. So leaders have a mind frame that we can determine our future simply by choosing what we do in the present. And in understanding this, what leaders say is very simple. Our future has no right to catch us by surprise. So Nigeria 2025 is not going to be built by people who are members of a mass choir singing a very unique song. That song goes like this, and I don't know whether I can find anybody within this mass choir that can help me. Are you ready? Somebody clear your throat now. Clear it. Are you ready? Okay, good. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be, the future I cannot see. Que sera, sera. What will be, come on. That is the mass choir of wimps. Not leaders. And I'm not calling you wimp. I was one that inducted you into this mass choir. But do you understand that the future does not create itself? Houses don't build themselves. You must decide what kind of future you're going to retire into. You must decide the kind of future you're going to give to the next generation. And I pray to God that it better be a future that they are grateful to inherit from you and you are proud to bequeath to them. And the worst thing that can ever happen is that you spend your life working. Don't forget, I said life is time and time is life. So you spend your life working on an organization that will not exist 3 years after you have left. It's usually what they call in human resource, they call it CV, career vacuum. When you look at somebody who's worked in an organization and when he presents his CV to you, you, and I don't want to call any particular name so that I don't go any oxes here. You see, the first organization he worked for no longer exists. And the second one that he left to work in after working 5 years also does not exist anymore. I really am tempted to call names, but then I won't do it. And by the time you look through this guy's curriculum vitae, all you can see is vacuum. Because there is nothing on that CV that still is in existence. Those are people who worked for the present. They never worked for the future. Leaders must have the capacity to create and deliver their desired future. So when you talk about delivering the future, we are talking about people who have the ability to make things happen. This has nothing to do, ladies and gentlemen, absolutely nothing to do with positions. And so I'm going to show you a 2-minute video, and then I hope that we'll be able to begin to get this thing to wrap up. I hope I have a few more minutes. All right? The True Leader video.
सर आपके लिए उस पार कार का इंतजाम किया है सर आइए सर चल चल
Ladies and gentlemen, can I quickly ask you a question? Who was the leader in that video? Did he have any position of authority? Was age a limitation? Did he have any particular finances to be able to solve the problem? Did you see the people that were already cutting contracts and deals on the problem? Did you see the people who were empowered and dressed up, uniformed, to be able to solve problems for them? Road traffic people, did you see them? What were they doing? So here it is. In a sense, what we learned from that video, and I wish I had more time to engage everybody, but because of my time is short. One of the four things that I learned, and I really want to just give you this, is what I call the ABCD of leadership. And I don't know whether you'll agree with me, but A means accept responsibility. That's what leaders do. Did that boy accept responsibility? Did he create the problem? But the fact that he didn't create the problem, did that stop him from accepting responsibility to solve it? Can you please whisper to the next person beside you, you must accept responsibility. Even if it is not necessarily your problem. That's what leaders do. Leaders accept responsibility. Number two, B, leaders believe. Did that boy believe in his own capacity to be able to try to move the tree? Yes, a tree that was literally his size. But somehow, he believed that there was something in him that had the capacity to move that great mountain. And let me help you understand it. Once he did it, he inspired the rest of the people. So one person's belief inspires the others to believe. Write it down. Your belief can inspire others to believe. C. He committed. And leaders commit. They commit their everything. They commit their time, their resources, their network. They commit everything they have and everything they own. Especially first to a set of values. And I will talk about that in a few minutes. But more importantly, to the cause. Leaders commit to the cause. Ask the person next to you, what cause are you committed to right now? And the last one I want to talk to you about very quickly before we begin to wrap this up is, leaders deliver. They don't attempt. The boy put his hand to the tree. Did the tree move? Did he go? So it doesn't matter how many times you've attempted this thing and who stopped you and who's not giving you support. If you believe in this cause and if you are a leader, you must continue to do what it takes until you deliver on that future. And what this whole thing shows us is that there are really like three levels of leadership, and there are many people who have different levels of leadership. So some people say 7 levels of leadership, 5 levels of leadership. I just want to show you 3. The first level of leadership is what I call the positional leader. This is the person who, in a sense, is leading because of the position that he or she occupies and the authority that is vested in that position. And when you look at those kind of people, the people following literally follow them because of the authority. The moment that person loses that position of authority, phew, shikena. This happened live and direct in a program which I was speaking around for a bank and teaching on leadership. And it turned out that when we got to one particular regional headquarters in the southeast, it was on a Saturday morning, and all the people were gathered, and the lady who had the key to the branch forgot the key at home. So here was one person who locked us out. And if you looked at her, she was not the branch manager, she was not the regional manager, she was literally, and so you begin to see power. She locked us out, and so she ran home to go and get her keys. Whilst we were standing there, a particular car drove up. And as that car drove up, I noticed that nobody engaged the person who was driving in the car until the car got right beside where I was and the guy who came with me from headquarters and the regional manager and a few of the branch managers. And then the guy saw the guy who came from the headquarters and came and said, Oga Chris, good to see you, sir. So he came down from his car and then he shook my hand, fella. And here I was trying to remember this guy. But all the other guys were literally just very cool. And they greeted him, how are you doing? And the guy, you know, having done his bit of a cheat, I didn't say cheat chat. Cheat is a one-directional monologue. You know, when you say how now, they don't answer. How you day? They don't answer. Everything's okay. They say, how is family? No answer. In fact, you people are looking. You know, you just continue until you are tired. And then he got into his car and he left. And the gentleman said to me, fella, you know, sometimes you don't even know what you teach. I said, what happened? He said, you don't recognize that guy. He said, that is the immediate past regional manager for this region. I said, it's not possible. He said, yes. I said, nobody greeted him. He said, ask them why. So we got in and I started teaching. When I got to this position, this point, I said, hey, come to think of it, there was one guy that came, that drove up, that you didn't answer. And he drove up in another official car. They said, you don't know him? I said, oh. He said, that guy was a terror. He said, if you come into the bank in the morning and you say to him, good morning, sir, he will say, what is so good about the morning? What have you done today to make my morning good? As you are trying to go, he said, no. I said, come on. I asked you a question, you have to answer. That means you are, and he can begin to walk waiting for his answer. What you have done today to make his morning good. He said, if you walk past him and you don't say anything because you don't want trouble, he will say, oh, so now I have become part of the furniture. He said to one person, on the day you were born, I can tell that your mother had no midwife present. So he then said to the person, ask me why. Ask me. That one too said, why, sir? He said, because when your mother gave birth to you, you came out with your head, but nobody to catch you, so you hit your head on the floor. For the first time in the history of that bank, the people wrote together, all branch managers wrote a petition to say, this guy either leaves or we leave. You see, that is a man who was a positional leader. His followers followed his instructions at best, but not his heart. And that guy is the kind of person we call a manager, aka ruler, aka, and you can call it anything, CEO, president, HR manager, anything. But it is something that is tied to something you can leave. Never carry a name and a psyche of anything that is transient. You know, when people become ministers and then they change, and then they become Madam Minister or Mr. Minister to you, they forget that it is only for a time and season. And those who then carry that thing realize by the time it's over that, oh my God, what do we do now? So they start to hold on to the shadows of that position by calling themselves former. If what you are doing today is not greater than what you used to do, you will use the appendage of what you used to be. How many of you today will leave your organization and the people will still call you? That's what managers are. The second level is what you call relational leaders. Relational leaders are the kind of people whose followers follow them because of the quality of the relationship that they have with the followers. And I'm going to quickly say something at this moment that you need to understand. Followership is not the opposite of leadership. Any leader that cannot follow instructions, ideas, is a doomed leader. So everyone has the capacity to follow. So you ask me a question, fella, what then is followership? Followers are all the people whose support and authorization and help you need to accomplish your vision. So every time your subordinate comes to meet you and presents you with an idea that you approved, you just followed your subordinate. True or false? So fella, what is the opposite of leadership? Rulership. Rulership is the opposite of leadership. Leaders inspire willing followers. Rulers subject and subdue their subjects. Let me move on quickly. The followers therefore follow decisions that the relational manager makes. And that's why those guys are called mentors. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get this right. How many of you here have mentors that are not people you report to? You have mentors in other organizations, even outside the corporate sector. How many of you have mentors? Do you report to them? Are they your managers? Okay, but do you realize that you are the one who chooses your mentor? Yes. In other words, the power of a mentor is in the mentee. Anybody that comes to meet you and says, Mrs. Amina Oyagbala, I must mentor you. No, that's not a mentor, that's a tormentor. You cannot force yourself. What do organizations do? We create mentorship and begin to allocate people to mentors. That is tormenting. It must be the people who choose their mentors. The third and the highest level of leadership in my own account here is the inspirational leader. And when I talk about the inspirational leader, I'm talking about a person whose followers follow because of the desirable results that they command in whatever sphere of their lives. The inspirational leader is the kind of person whose followers may not even have a direct relationship with him or her. He may not even know that they are following. And that's why those followers typically follow the examples. And these guys are called role models. Now, I don't know whether it's okay for you to tell me. Is it possible that you can have a role model that you don't have a mentorship relationship with? In fact, do you know that in 2002, David Beckham arrived at South Korea in Seoul with this haircut that we had never seen before, later to be known as the Mohawk. Within 24 hours, over 8,500 South Koreans had cut the hairstyle. Question is, did David Beckham tell them to do it? Did he have any relationship with them? But as long as he continued to bend it like Beckham, if they wanted to bend it, they say, we don't know whether it's his hair that is causing him to bend it. Anybody understand what I'm saying? So when you see the three levels of leadership, you see manager, you see mentor, and you see role model. Which to you is the highest level of leadership? Role model. Right. Fantastic. Now let's quickly look at this. Ultimately, you will realize that the tool by which people become role models is this thing called influence. Whilst the tool that people become positional leaders or managers is called control. That's why managers, pure managers, will always say to you, give me control, give me power over these people, I will rule them. I don't know whether you get what I'm trying to say. And most times, the only way these people, managers, can access that level of leadership is through the corporation. It's the corporate organization that makes them managers. But who makes you a role model? In the individual. So now I want to ask you one big question. This is the big one. Please don't shoot me. Please, I beg you. Okay? Listen. What do most HR managers do? We appoint someone as a manager and send him on a leadership course to learn about how to become a mentor and possibly then hope that he will become a role model. True or false? Is it true that most people go for their first leadership course as when they become supposedly leaders or managers? Meanwhile, what organizations should be doing is looking within your core of human resource capital and begin to say to yourself, who are the role models who have also learned how to share and inspire others? Those guys are the ones we should promote to managers. So we do the exact opposite. Which means that it is not when somebody becomes a manager that should be his first encounter with a leadership program. It is because he's gone on a leadership program that he becomes a better leader and therefore ultimately a better manager. Do you understand this? Does it make sense? And so what Jack Welch was saying is that, listen, I invest time in my people to make them leaders. In fact, Jack Welch was known to spend 65% of his official man hours at what they call the GE Leadership University. Leaders are people who have the ability to bring out the best in themselves and in others. They have the ability to influence others. And they will use their job role, their department, their corporate, their division, their everything until they are able to bring influence, change, through an entire generation. The greater the influence they exert, the greater the leader they are. So when you understand this, you can then make sense when you hear that a great Nelson Mandela said, sometimes it falls upon a generation to be great. He said, you can be that great generation. And I put, but you must let your greatness blossom. Is it okay for us to just, I don't know if you find anybody you want to advise this, and say to the person, sometimes it falls upon a generation to be great. Ours can be that great generation. But we must let our greatness blossom. Say to you, we must let our greatness blossom. Meaning we have a purpose to be great, not just successful. When you look at successful people, you can see things like income. These are the things that successful people look for. Income, and it's not bad. Respect, promotion, fame, rewards, positions, achievements. They want to make provision for themselves and their families. Prosperity is very high on their list. They're very ambitious people. And there is nothing wrong with success. The only problem is that when success does not land on the platform of greatness, then you have a challenge. So now it's not enough for you to be successful, you must be great. It's not enough for you to make an income because you have a job, you must ask, what impact am I making? An organization that told us that they could not invest in books for school children because they were looking for things that were hard, tangible, had just paid an international singer $1 million the week before, and she danced in Lagos for 37 minutes. She was supposed to perform for 45 minutes. Her husband came with her. And she had insisted if her husband did not come, she would not come to Nigeria. And they paid her husband $500,000 not to perform, to come with his wife. $1.5 million was committed to a bomb that they could not hold. And when they had the opportunity to buy a book that they believed in, they said, no, it's not tangible. This is what a generation can do to itself. When the people are so driven by income but not looking at impact. How do you measure greatness? Simple. The influence. Ladies and gentlemen, permit me to begin to then say to you that great leaders are people who have the capacity to bring change to their generation. My question is, are you a great leader? Are you a great leader? Because I believe you are. But great leaders have a different kind of thinking. They understand the difference between workers in employment and leaders in partnership. They understand that in every organization, you will have people who are just there because they want a job. That's workers. But leaders have a career. They are there because this is what they want to be best at. What do HR managers do? We carry people from department to department, not even asking them, what do you want to specialize in? So you find out somebody who has worked for 12 years but has had only 1 year experience in every skill set. Whereas abroad, you will hear things like, I have been this for the last 30 years. That's what makes the guy an authority and a guru. Workers in employment are people who think of what they can get out of the organization. Whereas leaders in partnership think of what they can bring to the organization. Ideas. Workers in employment rely on the organization to train them and build their competencies. And that's why they get so frustrated when you don't send them on training. But because leaders in partnership understand that this is my career, they accept responsibility. Remember I told you that. To build their own careers and develop themselves. Workers in employment serve their customers with a sense of duty. Leaders in partnership serve the customers with a sense of ownership. It's my customer, not their customer, not the customer. Workers in employment are people who are limited by existing set of rules that they have. They mostly put in their job description. Leaders in partnership will explore every way they can to solve problems in a way that does not break the rules or hinder the organization. So workers in employment will only do what they're required to do. But leaders in partnership will go the extra mile. Does anybody know some leaders in your organization? Which do you have more, workers or leaders? Now, do you understand that every organization has something called a leadership quotient? And the greater the number of leaders in your organization, the greater your ability to outperform your competitor. True or false? So ladies and gentlemen, do we agree that ultimately leaders in partnership will deliver an excellent organization to us? Do we agree that leaders in partnership will always outperform our expectations of them because they set higher expectations for themselves? Do we agree that leaders in partnership are those who will be driven by their own innate potential to use their targets, not just the things that we set for them? At best, workers will deliver good service to our clients. Nothing memorable. Nothing that makes the client want to come back. Leaders will deliver consistently an unforgettable experience. That's why leaders will do everything they can to reduce the cost of running the business. Leaders will do more for the organization in terms of ideas. A leader can never go into a desk and leave the desk the way it was before he met it. Workers in employment may not do much for your organization, but leaders will give a greater experience to your customers. That's why your customers will keep coming back. That's how you get more market share. That's how you build your market, and you ultimately are able to get greater profitability. So, ladies and gentlemen, do we agree? Do we agree that the greatest investment that any organization can make is not necessarily in building or equipment, but in unlocking the leadership potential in each of its workers? Do we agree that? Okay, good. So therefore, this is the most important thing I want to show you today. It's that the job of the HR manager in the 21st century is transferring your workers to become leaders, regardless of whether they have positions of authority or not. There must be a paradigm shift that starts first with the HR manager, that says, I am here to bring about change, not just maintain status quo. What is going to be different from the way that this thing was before and after? I'm not just here to bring an improvement. I am here to bring a transformation. Because the greater the transformation, ladies and gentlemen, the greater your leader. So I ask you, what do you see? Come on, people, talk to me. 1, 2, 3. Okay, have I lost you? I have just about 2 minutes more. What do you see? Fantastic. Let's do it together as one people speaking with one voice. 1, 2, 3, go! Ladies and gentlemen, let me put it in a way that I hope you understand. That experience in the time of innovation is not very valuable. What we have done over the last 10 years as HR managers will not position us for the next 10 years in building a new nation. We have to think differently. We can't look at the patterns that we have been working with and determine that these are the partners that are going to be done. HR managers must do something that I call radar. Please write it down. Radar. And if you can write RADAR, I will be happy. R means they must recognize leadership when they see it. Number two, they must attract leaders into their organization. I always ask the question, what is the point of mopping a floor when you have not shut the tap? Why bother to hire a worker when you can hire a leader? But does your recruitment exercise, does it have any way of testing the leadership quotient of the person you are trying to hire? Or is this just aptitude test? Number three, you must develop every worker to fulfill their leadership potential. Number four, you must activate them. Meaning release them, let them lead. And in leading, they must make mistakes. And if you kill your people every time they make mistakes and tell them you're on your own, then you will never groom a culture of leadership in your organization. But the last is that you must recognize leadership above results. Meaning that if people do the wrong thing but get the right results, you must not reward that. I came here to ask you a simple question. Does it matter how our people live their lives at home as long as they do their work in the office? Does it matter? I mean, does it matter that one guy went against one-way traffic so that he could arrive at the office on time? Even if he's not driving an official car? Does it matter what he does on Saturdays and Sundays? Ladies and gentlemen, you will therefore recognize that what it is that creates the way people behave are not necessarily just the values that we list on the wall. It's the software that runs the people. And so, basically, you've got to ask yourself, what is the software that is running the heart of my people? What is it that guides their decisions? What guides their actions? What makes them the way that they are and the way they behave? Ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that the internal programming of a human being is called their personal value code. And personal value codes can change. People have said it before, I'm trying to change the attitude of my people. I keep telling people when they come to hire me to say, Fela, please come and help us change the attitude of our people. I say, you cannot change people's attitude, but you can change their perception. If you change their perception, their attitude naturally changes. So there must be something that guides the way that they believe, the way they think. Because obviously their values will guide their thoughts and their decisions, and their thoughts and their decisions will guide their words and their actions, and that will determine the results. And the consistency of those results will become what we know as our reputation and our brand. So I want to submit to you, just by numerous, just numbering, 10 little things that you can tell your people and sell to them, regardless of whatever your organizational value code is. Number one, that your people should live a personal lifestyle of leadership and excellence. And that they must understand that they have a place in transforming their nation. Number two, that they must commit to these simple values. Number one, if you don't mind me, just number one value, make a positive impact on everyone you meet and everywhere you go. This has nothing to do with you in the office. Whether it's in the office or outside the office, get your people to want to make a positive impact on everyone they meet and everywhere they go. Number two, get your people to want to be solution providers and never a part of the problem to be solved. Be a solution provider, not a part of the problem to be solved. Number three, get your people to want to be role models worthy of emulation. In other words, let them all come up with a desire to be something that they want everybody else to be. Let them arrive at the office at the time that they hope everybody else will arrive. Number four, let them choose to be their best in all that they do, particularly the things they are naturally good at. And then let us put them in the places of their strength and their talent. Number five, inspire in them to do the right thing at all times, regardless of who is doing the wrong thing. 80 years of a tradition of excellence, and less than 12 people brought down an Arthur Anderson. After 80 years of great tradition, it's not enough that you do the right thing at some times, you must do it at all times, regardless of whether everybody thinks it's okay. Number six, you must value time and make the best use of it. Help them to understand that life is time and time is life. There are two time zones in the lifestyle of everybody. There are 9 to 5, which is what they give to you, but the time that they grow in life is between their 5 to 9 a.m. How they use it. Number seven, they must all care and show respect through their words and their actions. Number eight, they must consciously build a great legacy, starting today, now, and every day. Number nine, they must be people who want to live a lifestyle of integrity and honor. Like they say, integrity is the ability to say what you mean and mean what you say. Integrity is the ability to have no need for secrets and not to bestow secrecy or the burden of secrecy on another person. If I tell you something that I don't want you to tell Mrs. Oyagbola, and you tell her and I become disappointed, I am not a person of integrity. I should have said it in front of her for me to have said it in front of you. People of integrity don't collect things that they hope nobody will discover they collected. They don't give things that they hope nobody will discover they gave. But if I tell you that I'm going to slap you and I slap you, am I not a person of integrity? So now I also have to be a person of honor. And the last one, number 10, they must make their family, their organization, their nation, and their God proud. Ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, if half of your people worked by this value code, what will happen to your organization? It will transform. If a critical mass of this nation can believe in those 10 value codes and begin to implement them in their lifestyle, what will happen to this nation? But have you ever heard this thing before? You cannot give what you don't have. Therefore, if the HR manager does not first live by these value codes, it is impossible for them to share that value code. How many of you here would like to live by that value code? This is what Gemstone is doing. Gemstone is on a mandate to transfuse a new value system into our nation and our social consciousness. And we understand that it's something that we have to do at all levels. So in primary schools, over 300 primary schools, today we're teaching those 10 values to teachers, to students, and parents. In 78 campuses, every third Saturday of the month, people are gathering together, students are gathering in hundreds to learn how to live these values. Across 26 states in Nigeria, we have 33 training centers and growing, where every third Saturday of the month, people come in, some of them 100, some of them 50, and learn without a cost, because the cost of values can be too valuable that nobody can even pay for it. Ladies and gentlemen, it is important that we must be able to drive those values into family units, into schools and educational institutions, into corporate organizations like yourself. This is why I came. I came because we are driving a new value system into the heart of a new nation that you are going to retire into and you're going to bequeath. And I would love to partner with anyone here who would say, Fela, we need you to come to our organization or send your people. Because this, ladies and gentlemen, is the greatest challenge of our generation. You know it, I know it. We must transform our value system. And if our people can become great leaders, then, without doubt, we can build great institutions that would outlast those who founded it. We can build a great economy, because an economy is the summation of the well-being of each and every single person. We can build a new nation. We can deliver the future of Nigeria. The future of Nigeria can be significantly different from its past. I have a few cards here that have those 10 values on them. I don't have up to 1,600 of those cards. But if there's someone here who says, listen, fella, I'm not going to take this card if I don't want to live by it, if I won't share it with my family, if I won't share it with my organization, I won't take it. Please don't take it because you want to know what is on it. I've already told you what is on it. But if you take this card, I want you to take it because you're saying, fella, my people need to hear this. So can I have one? And this is basically what is going to make it happen. Please be a person of integrity. Don't take the card if you will not use it. Don't take the card if you will not drive it. But for as many people as are willing to say, fella, I want to live by these 10 values, I want you to please rise to your feet. Those ones that say, I want to accept this. Nobody, no, you don't have to. And please don't be shy to sit down. Don't be shy. Don't be shy to sit down. And we're going to say something together that I hope that you mean from the bottom of your heart. I will lead you in it. And for as many people as are standing, we'll try and give you the cards. Okay? But we will start by saying, my generation. No! No, 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 no. We are a people who have conviction in what we are saying. We are speaking from the heart, not from the brain. Somebody say with me, my generation is empowered, motivated, and stirred to operate with natural excellence. And this is my personal creed. On this 16th day of October, 2015, I, Fela Durotoye, hereby commit to live a lifestyle of leadership and excellence and to do all within my power to transform my country, Nigeria, into a most desirable nation to live in by December 31, 2025. Somebody say with me, to this end, I will make a positive impact on everyone I meet and everywhere I go. Will you do that? Then say with me, I will be a solution provider and not a part of the problem to be solved. I will be a role model worthy of emulation. I will be my best in all that I do, particularly the things I'm naturally good at. I will do the right thing at all times, regardless of who is doing the wrong thing. I will value time and make the best use of it. I will care and show respect to all through my words and my actions. I will consciously build a great legacy, starting now, today, and every day. I will live a life of integrity and honor. I will make my family, my nation, and my God proud. So help me God. I didn't hear you. Well, because you called yourselves a generation, is it okay for me to understand that you are an ambassador of this generation?
Yes.
And as an ambassador, three things you must do. You must say these things every day for the next 10 days. If you say it from the next 10 days, you will take it from paper onto the tablets of your heart. Number two, you must share it. Share it using your home platform. So those of you that pray together with your kids, let them say it with you. Those of you that have social media platforms, anybody here on Facebook, Twitter? For the next 10 days, take each one of these things and just post it. For those of you that know how to make picture cards on this, put it on a picture card, a poster card, and post it so that it looks nice. And then the last thing, you must show it. Let people be able to tell what your values are, even if you didn't tell them. Can you do this?
Yes.
Can you do this?
Yes.
Well, because you said you're ambassadors of a generation, do you mind if I just close by saying, Your Excellencies? Please, if you don't mind, stretch your hands to the next person to you and say, Your Excellency. I believe that together we will build a nation that we will be proud to give to our children, and they will be grateful to receive from us. I believe that you can, and I trust that you will do everything to build this nation with me. This is my commitment to you. I will not fail you. I will not fail CIPM. I will not fail Nigeria. And we will not fail God. This is the generation that must speak with one voice. Go out of this place as one people. Go and infuse these values into the hearts of your people. God bless you. God bless the CIPM. And may God bless the Federal Republic of Nigeria. Thank you very much for having me.
Well, fella, we are already standing. Do we stand there and give him another round of applause? Thank you very much. Thank you. We might be on our seats now. Thank you. Well, because of our time, we're already 10 minutes into what should be happening next. And there are several questions that people have sent to him. Maybe I'll just take one or two of the questions and then we'll round up. One says, are leaders born or made? Can anybody be a leader?
Well, I would always like to answer that question by saying I have never seen a leader that was not born. That person cannot be a leader, they must be a demon. So every leader is born. I also, of course, understand that what you're saying is, do people have innate leadership skills or not? Yes, there are people who have a natural inclination to take ownership of situations, to show responsibility and initiative, and to take action that will be accountable to many generations. We saw in that video a young boy that literally, I don't think he had been on a leadership course. I wouldn't assume that he had. So will that boy naturally be seen as a leader? Yes. But can people learn the skills of leadership? Absolutely. I think that leadership is a combination of four key things, and I call them four C's. Number one, leadership is competence, the ability to deliver desired results. Number two, leadership is capacity, the ability to handle the responsibility that is given to you, and of course, as it grows. Number three is charisma, the ability to inspire in others the willingness to come with you and to believe in what you believe. But at the heart of these three things is the fourth and the most important one. It's called character. So in my opinion, leadership is character, leadership is competence, leadership is capacity, and leadership is charisma. Leaders without capacity succeed at one level, but when they get to the next level, they fail because they don't have capacity to operate and lead at that next level. Can people learn competence? Absolutely, they can. Can they learn to grow capacity? Yes, they can. Can they learn the little traits that give them charisma? Yes, they can learn it. Some people have it more naturally than others. They can learn communication skills. They can learn, you know, the ability, what they call swagality. Have you ever heard that before? Swagality, that is the ability to swag. But most importantly, can we change people's character? Yes. If we change what they believe, if we change their perception, we can change and form their character. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have several questions here, but probably we'll be stopping here. Fellas agreed to also do short tea break with us, and you can interact with him, and then you have more thoughts from him. Let's put our hands one more time for this wonderful Nigerian. Thank you very much. A few quick announcements. All state chairmen are kindly requested to submit their contact addresses to Mr. Shola Joseph, the CIPM Director of Special Projects, and kindly do so before you leave. But we want to honor this wonderful person as I invite the immediate past president, Mr. Victor Famuyiwa, to step forward here and present the plaque to our guest speaker.
Have you been inspired like I have been this morning? If you have been inspired, please give him another round of applause. But I just want to say a big thank you on behalf of the president, my president, president of our institute and chairman of council, on behalf of everybody here. It's been a wonderful morning. You have really inspired us. I think we will go beyond after this. Definitely we will go beyond. We will be back to you. Yeah, this is not going to be the end. We have been on this journey to bring you here. I think this would be like the third time that we missed it out. But to be honest, you have really made the difference to us. We're so pleased, we're so grateful to you. Everybody here is thrilled. Everybody here is inspired today. Thank you so much. Thank you. God bless you. We have a token of appreciation in the best of our tradition, the tradition of the CIPM, and this will be it. We hope it will find prime of place wherever you keep the plaques. I'm sure you have received so many of these already, but please put these in the center of all the plaques that you have received so far. It is so important to us. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on your behalf, I present this to Fela Durotoye. Please give him another round of applause. Thank you.
Just to say, I want to say a very big thank you to each and everyone here, and hoping that my life really just didn't make a difference this morning, but that your life will make a difference through the things that we're doing together. And just to say that for those of you who didn't get the cards, is there anybody here who wanted a card but didn't get one? Can I see your hands up? All right, I want to do something that I trust you guys with this information. This is my personal number. This is my personal direct number. Okay, for those of you who would like to have it, I would like to be able to just send me a text, and then I will bring or send the card to you wherever you are in the country. And I promise to do it within the next 3 days. So that you don't lose the fire and you don't stop sharing. Okay. So my number is 0808 888 888. All right, did you get that? 0808 889 8888. There are 5 8s after the 9. All right? Did you get that? Okay. Then there's 0818 or 0818 881 8888. Okay? 0818 881 8888. Does anybody know why 8 is my favorite number? It's the number of new beginnings. We're building a new country. My email address is feladurotoye@gemstoneng.org. feladurotoye@gemstoneng.org. Please send me an email. I promise to respond to you within 24 hours, and we'll try and make this happen for you. Once again, thank you, CIPM. God bless you, everyone that is here. May God bless Nigeria. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.